sacred space, everybody. It's sacred space because you are here. And I'm going to introduce to you now, on 12-12-12, the eve of his birthday, my brother, Abel Muhammad, student minister to the Honorable Louis Farrakhan of the Nation of Islam. Welcome. Namaste.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. En el nombre de Allah, el benéfico, el misericordioso. In the name of Allah, the beneficent, the merciful. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah. We call him by many different names. In Arabic, we just say Allah. In Spanish, we would say Dios or El Señor. In English, we would use God, Creator, Grandfather. We have all these traditions with different names pointing to the same thing. So I don't want us to be confused by language today, because that's part of the old paradigm and the old system and way that things have been done to keep us divided from one another. I bear witness that there is no God but the one true God, who we believe appeared to us here in North America in the person of Master Farad Muhammad, a man with a black father and a Caucasian mother, coming from the holy city of Mecca here into America to look for a people who were lost, that he may guide them back to the straight path as a sign and a symbol of God's intervention, not just here in North America, but all amongst all of the oppressed people of the planet Earth. And we thank him for coming and for raising from us and for us and through us for all of humanity, a man born of ex-slaves from the land of called Georgia. A black man who also had Indian or indigenous roots that looked more Asian or Asiatic than black or indigenous. He was called Elijah Poole when he was born, but we know him as the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And I thank them, for I am a follower of his and his teachings, for his student that is amongst us today, that is misunderstood by almost everybody on the planet. And it's not by accident that a man who is judged and mocked and even ridiculed for what he does, yet he does what other people can't do. I'm the son of Mexicans, born here in America, which you would call Chicano or Mexican-American, whatever term you want to use, but I didn't know who or what I was until I met the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. And it was that beautiful man who enlightened me and is raising me up where I can be a decent human being, a decent father, a decent brother, where before I was somebody that you might have seen on the news someplace, doing illegal, illicit activities. Now I'm striving to be a good father, striving to be a good husband. And I want to thank God for the opportunity and blessing of representing those men here tonight at this beautiful event. And I want to greet you again in the greeting words of peace. We say it again in the Arabic language, Assalamu alaikum. And those words simply mean in English, peace be unto you. But in a world like this, there's really nothing better that we can offer one another than peace. All of the beautiful spirit that we just felt for that last half hour in this, you know, relatively small space in one sense, but the energy was so big that if we could keep that energy and transpose it out of these doors onto the world, what a different place Pilsen would be. What a different place Chicago would be. And that really is the challenge of this time, isn't it? There have always been houses and cloisters and places where people come to relive and recapture sacred traditions, but then something happens. We go to the church and we get sanctified. We go to the mosque and we get inspired and we say our prayers or we get baptized or we take an oath of some sort of service and we go and we will even dedicate ourselves to hours and days and years of just meditating on ourselves. But if that power cannot then be transformed into a transformative power in the world, then what's it all for? If we claim to be enlightened people in a world submerged in darkness, then either something is wrong with us or we're liars and deceivers in saying that we are enlightened. Here's the whole world right here. I didn't grow up on 18th Street, but this is where I became alive. In 1994, 95, as a young man, these were much rougher streets back then, and they're still pretty rough now. But I remember just across the street over here at the park, I was walking with a friend of mine, a sister, and we hear gunshots in the park. And there's a little young 17-year-old boy getting shot by another 17-year-old Mexican right in front of the Mexican Fine Arts Museum, at that time it was called. Right up the street from a church, right down the street from a school, all these places which are dedicated to the enlightenment of us as human beings. Yet right in the middle of that, death is all around us. Darkness is all around us. But that's what we're here for, isn't it? We're here today because that was the old paradigm, the old way, and it's time for a new way of doing things. And it's not just because the date is 12-12-12, though it is significant. But that's a sign that the new is coming in. And with your permission, I wanted to start just the brief words I'm going to share with you tonight from the Holy Quran. My favorite, if I can have a favorite one, chapter of the Holy Quran is the 103rd surah. Surah just means chapter in Arabic. And it's called Al-Asr, or the time, or the era. And it says, it's very short, it reads, in the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. I bear witness, oh, I'm sorry, in the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. By the time, surely man is in loss, except for those who believe and do good, and exhort one another to truth, and exhort one another to patience. That's the whole chapter for you. So much in there, though. You notice it didn't say everyone's going to hell except for those who are Muslims. It said, surely man, all of humanity, it doesn't matter if we're black, brown, red, yellow, or white, call ourselves Christian, Muslim, Jews, or otherwise, if we consider ourselves pagan, if we consider ourselves heathens even, if we consider ourselves disbelievers and atheists, all of humanity is in loss today. It says, except for those who believe. It doesn't say those who are Muslims, those who are Christians, those who are Buddhists, those who are Jews, those who believe. Well, what is it that you and I believe? Because what we believe is not the label we put on ourselves. What we believe is manifest in our actions today. So it's a very simple formula that's given. Every human being is lost except for those who believe. And then based off that belief, there's activity that comes with that. That makes sense, doesn't it? If I tell you I'm an electrician and the lights are off and I come in the building and I can't fix the lights, how believable is my statement that I'm an electrician? If I say I'm a chef and you're hungry but I can't put something together for you to eat, then it doesn't matter what I call myself, what are the actions manifesting of who or what I am? So what we want today is not people who call themselves enlightened, not people who are just seeking enlightenment, but those who are actually manifesting that enlightenment. And that has to be true and sincere and from the place we were all just meditating on, our hearts. It doesn't matter what I say to you. It could be beautiful. It can sound good. But if I go outside and you see me doing something opposite of the words I just shared with you, then the weight of the word, the value of the word, the power of the word is deprived now from what I just shared with you and I. And the books of scriptures that we have called Bible, Quran, all of the scripts that we have from our ancient ancestors, and even those that are being revealed to us today through these meditative processes, which have been hidden and were never written down, but they were written down in our hearts, in our conscience, in those places which we're beginning to re-access today. And I'm saying all of that basically just to get to this point. It doesn't matter what we say today. It doesn't matter what we call ourselves today. It's what we do. It's our actions that will not only define us, but it'll define and redefine the world we're living in. So if we're not happy with the condition of the world, then we have to look not at the outside, but we have to look in ourselves. If what we're trying to establish is peace out there, how can we live in turmoil and then want peace to be established out there? Have you noticed the hypocrisy that exists? Just here in the city of Chicago, you have the mayor and the police department condemning the young brothers that belong to what they call the gangs. We call them street organizations. Because if they were up in Wilmette or Winnetka, they wouldn't be called gangs. They'd be called young men who need guidance. They need reform, but because they're black and brown, they're called gangs. And that's significant because it's beyond color today, but it does have something to do with color.
That's the old world that we're coming out of, a world built off of an idea which is corrupt at its core, and it's an idea that some can be better because of an exterior feature. Some can be better because we're male versus female. Some can be better because we have versus those who have not. I am better because I believe in this prophet while you don't believe in the same prophet I do. I'm better because I belong to the organization that lives on this street and you're on that street, so I'm better than you. We're now clashing with one another. My tribe is superior to your tribe. This goes back a long, long way. But this new era that we're in, it's not about what we call ourselves, it's about what we do. And I'm here to represent a man in the next few minutes that does more with his 80 years that he's almost been on the planet than most who you and I have been told we should emulate, we should idolize. And I'm speaking of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. There's a man, they call him an anti-Semite, yet you see him speaking in Jewish synagogues. You see rabbis coming to his home. I have to say this because how can you and I know better, do better, act better when we don't know better? Here's a man who at 80 years old, I've walked with him just this summer, right on the streets of South Chicago, right in the streets of the West Side, just going and speaking to the brothers that the police are coming to arrest. Yet out of love in his heart, he goes and he doesn't just tell them, you have to be a Muslim, you have to be a Christian. He doesn't come trying to offer them, sell them, or convert them to anything. He goes with a pure heart and asks them, what can I do to help you, brother? You know what all these young men that we've talked to over the summer have said to us? The ones who are at the bottom, the plagues that plague the society, so-called, that are selling drugs and doing these illegal things. You think these young, beautiful, black and Hispanic and all other colored children want to sell drugs? You think they like walking around with pistols on them? Who glorified for that for them? Who made that an acceptable way of life? And how come we see a man as our enemy when he's going to do a work that no other man can do? We've been deprived of the knowledge of who we are, black, brown, red, yellow, and even white people. We have no idea who we really are. And it's not enough for us to just come and say, well, I have a sense of who I am. I'm beginning to meditate and accept and better and have a better understanding of myself. It's not enough if we can't then take that same energy and go to the so-called worst of our people. Because that's ultimately what this is all about. We can't be any greater than the least of our people. And if we see homeless people, if we see hungry people, if we see hopeless people out in the streets and we have light, then why are we hiding our light from them? Is it because we're not necessarily really what we should be? And that's my challenge to all of us today. Can we go beyond the limitations and our comfortability? It's easy to decide to meditate when you want to meditate, in the comfort of your space, but can you go and transform a space? Because if you and I can't do that, then we don't really have the power of what we're saying from our mouth. And I'm not saying it out of anger, out of bitterness, I'm saying it out of a plea. Because if we as the enlightened people can't come together, how can we tell those young brothers and sisters out there, you all have to stop the madness, you all have to come together, when we as Christians, Muslims, Buddhists, whatever name we want to call ourselves, I'm all of those things, and so are you. But we have to go beyond those labels today, because the time that we live in, our young people don't care what we call ourselves. They're not impressed because they see you with a yoga mat. They're not impressed because they see me with a bow tie and a suit on or a nice car. They don't care about that. They want to know, do you care about me? They took a poll this summer in Inglewood, where I live on the south side. And you know what they said? They asked these young people in high school, at Inglewood High School, as a matter of fact. They asked them if there's something you could be given that would help you to make it, to, you know, to get through high school, to make it in life. What would it be? You know what they said? A parent. Now they may have a mom or dad at home, so they say, what do you mean? Well, you live with your mom, don't you? You live with your dad? Yes, but they don't parent. They don't do the activity, the action of what they're supposed to do. So you say you're a Christian, then why aren't you like Christ? You say you're a Buddhist, and how come your light is not enough to transform the environment around you? We say we're Muslims. Well, then how come our submission to God's will is not enough to help those who are out of the will of God? It is because we're not doing what we claim from our lips. And that's something that is, in this world, we would call that being a hypocrite. When you say from your and my lips what we don't have in our hearts to do. So this is really an operation we're having tonight on 12-12-12. A 30-minute transformative operation to transform our hearts, to remove whatever's keeping us. And it always starts with self. If we want peace out there, there has to be peace here. Well, how does it start? What kind of thoughts am I thinking? Beyond that, what kind of food am I putting in this? What am I putting in this living temple that is supposed to go out there and transform the big temple of the earth? How can we do that? How can we say that from our mouths, yet we have no actions? Nothing in our life that allows us to change our own life, much less somebody else's life. And if we're not here to serve one another, then what's it all for? You can't have peace by yourself. It's impossible. We can achieve a level of comfort, but not real peace. Peace is when we are allowed to be free, justified, and equal, and be what we are created to be. We can't be that in a world like this. I don't know, is our little sister here? Where's Maya at? Brother Daniel brought, how old are you, Maya?
Seven.
Let me have Amatala come here too. I want you to meet these two little girls. This is my daughter and Brother Daniel's daughter. Just come up here. 10 years old and 7 years old. Come on up here, babe. This is Amatala and Maya. Just stand here for a second. Come on. Come here. Now, this is mine from my wife's womb, but she's not mine because I didn't create her. I could have never created something this magnificent. There was another power involved here. This is mine also though, not physically, but this is Brother Daniel's physical daughter, yet these are like my daughters. You all are like my sons, my brothers, my sisters. Why? Because we come from the same source. I'm not her father as belonging. She belongs to me in some way. No, I'm allowed to be her father to see if what I say from my mouth will allow me to grow and develop enough to be entrusted with fathering over something that does not belong to me. They are not my possessions. Neither is my wife. Your mates are not your possession. They're a test for you and I. You all can go sit down. Thank you. I just wanted to see them to see how beautiful you look. Now, in this world, they're made to feel possibly odd because they cover themselves. They cover their hair. I don't ask my daughter to cover herself. Her mother taught her why she should cover herself. And because of that, she likes dressing like that. I love that she dresses like that. But it's not because she wants to be flamboyant or known. She wants to represent herself in a respectable way. That's beautiful. But if then she doesn't follow that up by living a life that is just as decent, just as moral, just as respectable, then that's just a costume. And that's our problem today. We're costume people. Costume wearing the costume of an enlightened human being, the costume of a Christian, the costume of a saved person, the costume of somebody who cares, when in our heart it's corrupted. And the only way to change that is that we must be what we intend and are designed to be by the Creator Himself. All of us, regardless of the color of our skin, regardless of our age, we have something to offer for the betterment of all of us as a whole. But we cannot do that until we first have a new mind. This new paradigm, this new era that we've entered into, it cannot start until we accept a new way of thinking, a new idea, a new thought. And what is at the root of the idea must be something totally different from the old idea and the old world that is going out. Is that all right with everybody? I'm going to read you a couple of quotes and then we can go home. You have to forgive me because I'm losing my wife is sick. Well, let me start here. 12 and a half and 13 days ago, she gave birth to our third daughter. So I'm a new dad as well as everything else. All praise is due to Allah. She went into labor during the full moon on the eclipse moon on the 29th. And it lasted 22 hours. And then she still had to be operated on. But the baby and her are both happy and healthy and home by the grace of God. But we named her because at the time we're in Sophia Maria. Because Maria is a very significant name. My daughter that you met, her first name is Amatala, but her middle name is Tonansi. Which, if you know, that's a very significant name as well. The first name, Amatala, means the female servant of God, and Tonansi means mother of the gods. So that's a very powerful name that she has. But I'm saying all of that because my wife actually is home today. She's not with us, not just because she just gave birth, but also because she's got home with the stomach flu. So as you all go home tonight, I was happy that you're meditating and keep her in your prayers so that she can be relieved of whatever discomfort she's having. But I want to read you a quote from my teacher, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, because what we're at the beginning of here is a new time, or what we would call civilization. Everything around us must be transformed and changed, but it will only happen when something else changes about us. Civilization begins with the knowledge, and a civilization ends when the knowledge that originated the civilization begins to decline. That makes sense, doesn't it? When those ideas that the civilization is built on begin to fall or falter, then that civilization goes the way of that idea. Makes sense. We are living in a world and in a civilization that was given by God a certain time to exercise itself. But it was also prophesied that the civilization or world in which we live would come to an end. This means that the knowledge that guides this civilization would reach a point where it is no longer would be effective in solving the problems presented by the time. Therefore, at that time, or we could say this time, at this time, that knowledge would be like a light that has gone out. Darkness would then come over the people, and this would lead to such dissatisfaction that it would call into existence a change factor. That's what we see right now, don't we? You want to change the economy for the better? Good luck. You want to change the society for the better? Go have it. You want to change the educational system for the better? They're looking for help. You want to help trade? You want to help the Palestinian and Israeli situation? Go have at it. You want to put an end to the discomfort and the turmoil that you and I see? We go into school and we get master's degrees, PhDs that say we're qualified to be a doctor in medicine, a doctor in science, a doctor in economics, a doctor in societal ills. Yet look at all these sick and crazy people. Where are our good, are our PhDs doing this? They're not, because we've been bought and sold on a pack of old ideas that no longer work in this new paradigm that we live in. All praise is due to Allah. All the prophets and messengers of God and the sages that are recorded in history brought with them knowledge, or what you and I would call light. That's what we're talking about, isn't it? When we say light, we're not thinking because this electrical instrument turns on, now everything's going to be better. But similarly to the way this electrical instrument turns on, this electrical instrument has to turn on. A torchlight is a guiding principle, so education must guide the civilization, and inherent in that education is the idea that fuels that civilization. What the question we have to ask is, what is the new idea that we want to fuel the new civilization? Because the one of the old does not work in this dispensation of time. And if we're hanging on to the old, we're going to go the way of the old, which is out. If you ever noticed, when new things come that are better than the old idea, nobody's upset that the old idea is gone, is there? How many of you still have phonograph machines in your home? Just a few, because we like being old school. But when you got the MP3 that carries 1,000 songs, try carrying 1,000 pieces of vinyl around with you. First came the Walkman, right? Then CD players, and nobody got upset when that old phonograph machine now had you tied to your home. Everybody was happy. Now with the iPads and iPods and everything else, everybody's happy. I can download for free 1,000 songs illegally, and nobody has anything to say about it. But everybody's happy, right? If you strapped your own phonograph machine to a belt and walked around outside with it, with 1,000 records, people would look at you like you were crazy. Why? Because the idea and the time of the phonograph machine is gone. Remember when TVs used to be this wide and the screen was only this thick? Now the TVs are this wide for you to view and only this thick going back. Nobody was upset when they made HD TVs. Nobody said, man, I like the fuzzy and the bunny ears and I like having static on my TV. I don't want no HD. Everybody was happy. Why? Because not only was it a new idea, it was a better idea. That's the time we're in today. It's not just a new time. It has to be a better time. Well, who makes it a better time? Who had the idea for the iPad? Who had the idea for the HDTV? Did it fall out of the sky or did it come up out of human beings, men and women like you and me? Which gets us right to the point I really want to get to. 12-12-12. This is the day that's venerated over Mexico and Central America as the Dia de la Virgen de Guadalupe. I happen to have a painting of her, or a picture of a painting. They call her La Virgen Morena, the dark skin, the black virgin. It's interesting because all the angels around her are white. But they call her the black virgin. She was said to have appeared to an indigenous man in Mexico about 500 years ago now, all right? Some people make mock of it and make mock of Mexicans because we think we see her everywhere now. We find her on Dorito chips. We find her on pieces of bread. We find her on stains in the wall. Because we're looking for a sign that God cares about us. A people who are suffering, who are mistreated, who are oppressed and don't have a champion, they're always looking for some way to connect with a force more powerful than themselves. And God always intervenes in the affairs of human beings. The children of Israel were raised up because Moses was raised for them. The children of Israel in the Palestinian, or the area called Palestine, were raised up because a man named Jesus was raised for them. The Arab people were united and became a force in the world because Muhammad was raised up for them. God always interacts in our affairs and intercedes amongst the oppressed through human beings. It might be a man, it might be a woman, but it's never a chicken. It's never a horse. It's always somebody who looks like you and me. Why? The Holy Quran says it like this. If you were an angel, I would have sent you an angel. But because you're flesh and bone, we'll only listen to other material beings. Even those of us who have had visions and encounters, they look something like us, don't they? They communicate in our language, don't they? They have limbs. There's even a story in the Bible, in the Old Testament, where Abraham sees three people walking on the plains of Mamre. And he knows that one of them is the Lord. And he asks him, Lord, are you hungry? I can cook something for you. Well, if God doesn't have a stomach, what does he need to eat for? He asks him, are you tired? Sit down and rest. Let me wash your feet. So God has feet. All of us who came up in the church reading that Bible, it has been misrepresented to us, making us think outside of the physical reality of who we, what we are, so that we could never see ourselves because we are human beings as divine. Every human being is divine. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said it like this, every time you're looking at a black man, you're looking at God. I want you to think about that. Why did he say the black man? Because the black man is on the bottom rung in the society. When you see the homeless brother in the street under Wacker Drive, you're looking at God. You're looking when you see the sister on the corner selling her body because she doesn't see another way out. You and I are looking at God. When you look in the mirror, you're looking at God. But what is God? God is something with force and power. Well, if you and I don't have force and power, then how can we claim to be God? And there is no greater force and no greater power than to know yourself. And to know the ability we have, then develop it, develop that ability, and ultimately exercise that ability. Isn't that beautiful? Wouldn't that make you and I peaceful and happy and joyful to be able to do what I was born to into the world to do? But nobody's ever taught us. So our children go to school and they drop out. Why? Because I don't like math. I don't like reading. How can you not like what you are? Our children are mathematics. Our children are history. You and I are everything that we study. It's the microcosm of the macrocosm. But we've never been taught like that about ourselves. And in particular, those of us who come from the indigenous and black, we've been made totally blind to who we are. So he focused specifically, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, on black people. Why? Because if I can go into America and raise up black people who people around the world see as a people without hope, then what can I do with everyone else? If I can take the hopeless and clean them up, take us out of gutters, take us out of crack houses, take us out of prisons, take us out of the lowest places in society and make us look dignified. And it not just be a costume, but actually make us live the life that we're speaking from our mouth, then what can I not do for white people who are lost, brown people who are lost, Asians who are lost? All of humanity is lost today. All we need is the right idea today. And we're living in a time, by the show of this beautiful audience, we're living in that time where we are beginning to see past color, past label. But this is a small group in here. We know that this is not necessarily the overall view out there, right? So then this is our challenge today. How can we come together? Oh, thank you so much. My voice is going. All right, that's better. But how can we come together? If we can't see past our divisions, how can we challenge our people to see past their divisions? If we can't embrace one another, if we were in a room with Jesus, Muhammad, Buddha, and all of our ancient ancestors, if we saw them all in a room together, they wouldn't be quarreling with one another. They wouldn't be fighting and trying to convert one another. Could you imagine how ridiculous that would be? Jesus telling Muhammad, oh, you got it wrong. The Father told me to do it this way. And Moses coming in with his tablets, you know. No, he wrote it for me. I got it in writing from God. And Buddha just in the corner being quiet. But all praises due to. I'm just a little levity. Because I'm not going to be much longer, but I wanted you to get. It's silly, right? But this is how childish we are. The Honorable Minister Farrakhan gave us this beautiful analogy of how we act as so-called enlightened people, arguing and afraid to be in a room with one another while the whole world is going to hell, but you won't sit with me because I wear a bow tie. I won't go in a room with you because your skin is lighter, your hair is straighter. I won't go in a room with you because I'm from the South Side and you live up north. That's silly, right? This is the problem. Imagine we've all been through first, second, and third grade, most of us, right? Probably the ones who haven't are the most enlightened amongst us. To be honest, I have to tell you, because my teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, never made it out of the third grade. Yet he's the man on whose shoulders we stand on today. Now think about that one. He's the one who taught Malcolm X, who only had an eighth grade education. And Malcolm went to Oxford, he went to Yale, he went to Harvard, and whooped the best that this world had with the knowledge that the eighth grade man got from the third grade man. They couldn't defeat Malcolm X. How? Muhammad Ali, you love Muhammad Ali, right? Not because he threw some bad hooks and jabs, but because of his mouth and his character. But he was made by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. That man only went to high school. So he took a high school man named Cassius Clay, gave him the name Muhammad Ali, sent him out into the world, and this man with no education took the education from the third grade man and beat the hell out of the known world and is the people's champion all over the world. How come you don't know anything about Muhammad Ali? He made the Honorable Imam Waruddin Muhammad, who some of you know, some of you may not know, his son, respected all over the world for the largest conversion of people to so-called Orthodox Islam in the world when he took the Nation of Islam so-called to Orthodox Islam. But he was made by his father, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And the man I represent, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, brought almost 2 million men to Washington. Somehow nobody cares. Most of them Christian. Black men paying their own way on a Monday to go to DC, not to beg for jobs, not to beg for housing, not to beg for help, but to ask God to forgive us for not accepting our responsibility as men. Who but a God-guided man could do something like that? And how can you see him as something other than that? You don't judge a man by what the media says. You should judge a man by his works. And that's our problem today. We know the media lies to us, but we still somehow are consumed by their web. That's why it's called the World Wide Web, because we're all tangled in it. But there's a chapter in the Holy Quran called the spider that talks about how the spider feeds on lightweight insects that get caught in its web, because it has to be a lightweight insect to get caught. Then it comes out and it injects with like a needle something inside of the form of the being that has been caught there, the mosquito or whatever, the fly that gets caught in the web, and then that dissolves the inside of what is caught, but it leaves the outside like it is. That's our problem today. We look like enlightened people. We wear the mask, we wear the bow tie, we cover our heads, we dress that cool, enlightened look. We got that sophisticated talking language, but inside, have we been poisoned already? Luckily for us, there's an antidote today. And I want you to know it, because I want you to look at a man that you've been kept from, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Well, they said he was a black nationalist. No, black is not national, black's not local, black is universal. Because everything comes from black. When all of us, regardless of how white we are or how black we are, when we were in the womb of our mother, there was nothing but blackness around us. The Holy Quran says it was triple blackness. This outside is not real darkness. This is the shadow of the light of the sun that we're in by the rotation of the earth and the angle of the earth versus the sun. But that's not darkness. Darkness is the womb of the mother. So all of us come from that. So if we say, and we say we should pay homage to blackness, no one should be offended. Every human being had to have come from black people. Because black people can produce light, but the light can't produce the dark. Nothing wrong with that, is there? That's science. Those are facts. That's scientifically provable, that two Caucasians cannot produce a black person. But you and I have seen what they call albinos. And you can take two of the blackest people and the child can come out with blonde hair and blue eyes. But two blonde hair and blue eyed people will never give birth to somebody who looks, as the Bible describes the Christ, as feet burnished with brass and hair with lamb's wool, like lamb's wool. But how come we've been made to turn that off? Because somebody has been working on us subtly, even in our enlightened community. I want to share this with you, and I'm going to close. I know I'm not going to be able to finish everything I wanted to say to you, but I think it's important to get this point to you. In the Holy Quran, there's an angel or a being who didn't want to bow down to God named Iblis. And he's having a discussion in the Quran. And he's angry because God tells Iblis, he tells all the angels to bow down to the man that he's created. Call him Adam, right? All of them bow because angels have to obey God, right? All of them bow except this one called Iblis. He was a fiery character. He was hastily made. And so God asks him, Iblis, didn't you hear my command? How come you didn't bow? Listen to Iblis's answer. He says, I didn't bow because I'm better than him. Here's a being that God created. The creator instructs him to do something, yet the being apparently had free will because he disobeyed. Not some robotic thing that just followed orders. He disobeyed, yet he made a judgment about the creator, and then told the creator, I think you're wrong. I know you made me and you made him, but I think you got this wrong. How can I bow to that which I'm better of? He said, I'm made of fire while he's made of dust. And that's the mind of this world. A world that believes in the exceptionalism of America. A world that believes and thrives on elitism. An imaginary middle class that has to feed off of the poor and the underclass. That's the sick world we live on and off of, and it will only be destroyed when we destroy that mind, and we have to subtly and overtly release ourselves from the pull and the weight of that world, which is pulling us down into destruction with it. That's what's wrong with our lives as enlightened people. We know the truth, we feel it, we are in touch with it in our meditative and prayerful states, but then we wake up and we go back and work in a world for the benefit of a world that God Himself and all of the masses of the people are totally dissatisfied with, and it's time for it to go. But until we get together and start reforming, reorganizing, and reshaping a new reality, then there is no new paradigm that's going to exist. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I'm closing with this, and the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, teach us.
Let me take a sip before I say this.
That's perfect. I could use that as a good prop right here. He said, it's not so important what we say to one another. It's how we live. If you want somebody to be better, let's be better ourselves. And then all we have to do is be the clean cut. And when people start looking at you and I and they see the cleanliness of us, I'm not talking about wearing a suit. This is not necessarily cleanliness, because the biggest crooks in this world wear suits. The biggest thieves in this world wear suits and ties and expensive shoes. We're talking about the quality of our life. Are we liars? Is our word our bond? Do we say what we mean? Do we love? Do we care? And do we show it? That's what we are. That's the clean cup. And as people look at the clean cup, they'll look at the dirty cup next to it. Our own lives, our old lives, their own lives that they're unhappy with. You don't have to condemn the dirty cup. Just work on being the cleanest cup you and I can be. And then our people's own nature will condemn themselves, and they'll come to you and I. Sister, brother, you're always smiling. You're always happy. You always say something nice to me when everybody walks by scornfully looking at me. What is it about you that's different? I've seen the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan change the hearts of people who don't speak the same language as him. Just from being around him and observing him on a day-to-day basis, people who work for him on a farm that we have out in Indiana, we have one in Georgia too. But I met a group of Mexican brothers who hardly don't speak any English. But when I met them, they've never heard a lecture of his because they don't understand enough English to hear him. Yet when I talk with them, they're just in love with him. And I said, well, what is it, what is it that you want? They said, I want to be like him. Whatever it is that he is, I want to be that. They're not talking about his suits or a car. They're talking about the way he treats them. And I asked them, well, be specific. How does he treat you? They said, he's good to me and my family. That's our teaching. That's our way. If we're enlightened, let's treat people not giving tit for tat, but let's treat them in the best manner. Let's show them not give respect when respect is given. No, respect them anyway, because our people have never been taught to love and respect themselves. So you can't expect a dead person to respond in a living form when there's no life in them. We can give them life. And we have life, and we can give them life more abundantly if we do this. And I'll close. 12, you can read the whole thing when you get home. I'm sure some of you haven't read the whole book. No. Revelations chapter 12, since this is 12, 12, 12. It says, and there appeared a great wonder in heaven. Remember this? A great wonder in heaven. A woman clothed with the sun. See the sun behind her? And the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, travailing in birth, and pained to be delivered. Then it goes down and it says, and she brought forth a man child, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up unto God and to his throne. There's a lot of science in there. We won't get into it all tonight. The significance and the importance of it is in this. If we want new people, new ideas, it all starts with the woman. What do you mean it starts with the woman? You ever heard the term, the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world? You're the first teacher. Every human being ever born on the planet, from the best of them to the worst of them, came out of the womb of some woman. Well, there's test tube babies, yeah. And the test tube has to have the essence of a man and the essence of a female or feminine, right? In order to produce child, you can't escape it. So if we want a better world, it has to start with the woman. 75% of the work, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, is with the female. Why? Because if you are left to be disrespected, injured, hearts broken, mistreated by the men of this world who do not seek a virtuous woman, then how are we going to make a better world with broken women? How are we going to make a better world with women who don't raise their sons to be respecters of women? We're taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad that the woman is the first creation in the universe after God himself. She's called the second self of God. Before he made a sun, before he made a moon, before he made the stars, he made the female, and he made her exclusively from himself. The secret of all we want to do is caught up in the woman. And as men, how we relate to her, how we maintain her, how we protect her, how we honor her will direct what we produce from her. And as women, the way you elevate yourselves, what you feed on, what you allow yourself to be subjected to, because we don't know our own power of the feminine strength we have. If we are not awakened to it and alert to it and then live in it, we allow ourselves to be demeaned by lesser men who should have no access to you. I hope you understand what I'm saying. If you want to see the world change, I'm going to tell you right now. I know it's popular to do all these things, and I'm not here to talk about other aspects of this. We're not here to talk about same-sex men. That's irrelevant in what we're talking about here. Every human being is born from a woman, regardless of what path that human being takes once it comes out of the womb. Comes from a woman. That alone should tell us the value of the woman. That's why this Mary is held up for us. La Virgen Morena, because particularly it's the black, the brown, the red, the indigenous and dark African women, but all women in general, that have been devalued. And because the woman is devalued and she's the first teacher of the child, then the man grows up with a misperception of his own mother, which then makes him misperceive all of creation because he's misperceived the key to God's creation, which is the woman. If we want to change, it starts with the woman. Not her being put in some corner. No, she must be liberated and freed to be and know who she is and then be what she's intended to be. And you are the second self of God. You are co-creators with God. The man is not. We have one saying, and I think it personifies all I'm trying to say to you. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us that when you teach a man, you teach an individual. When you teach a woman, you teach a nation. That's powerful. But do you see yourself as the powerful co-creator with the creator? Not a subordinate to him, co-creator, equal. God, the creator, works in your womb to create that which will better humanity. We've been looking at that moon for thousands of years until a child was born with the science and mathematics to produce a rocket and an engine that would propel man to that moon. We've been looking at the sun, looking at the ocean until women's wombs gave birth to individuals, men and women, who knew how to calculate, how to send a submarine underwater, how to manufacture a device by which we could view into the heavens, under the earth. That all came from you. How come we don't know our value? How come we think we're supposed to be changing a man? How come we think we're chasing a man, not then changing him too? Chasing. How come we as men don't know the value of women and we think there's something to play with and then toss off once we've conquered it? Because we've been mistaught, mistrained about everything, and that is the base of the old world's idea. Conquer. Conquest. That's not the time we live in today. The new world must be a world based off freedom, justice, and equality, where we're judged not by what we look like, not by just what we say, but our actions. What we do with our lives and what we do for the benefit of humanity should be glorified, should be exalted, and will be if this group here, this little group, could be the light of the world. If we decide that from this place we will not allow those false barriers to divide us anymore, but we'll go forth from here as true warriors, rainbow warriors, of every spectrum of the light, representing that truth which we were born in. This is the time not of going back to recapture some distant past. It's about accepting the new glorious future which our ancestors told us was coming. There's a reason Amaya saw an end to a cycle and couldn't see past it, because the light of this group of people blinded our prophets and seers. They couldn't see past the beauty of what God was creating today. The question then is, will you accept the responsibility to be a light, a torchlight in this darkness, and to go out and not with us be the same old wineskin, but make ourselves into new creatures, new beings, so that the new wine, the new wisdom, the new knowledge can be poured into us, and we could reach our people regardless of what the world says they are. There are no hopeless people out there. There are only people with hopeless minds who don't have a proper knowledge to affect the change in this world. So I thank you for listening as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum. I asked, we were supposed to have Brother Imam Sultan with us today, but he couldn't make it because of a family issue that he was dealing with. But he asked me if I would close us out with the prayer, the call to prayer, from our Muslim tradition. And those of you, just in whatever manner is comfortable, if we could all stand. I want to tell you what I'm going to say in Arabic first, just so you know what it is. And you'll have to forgive my voice, so I won't be able to project it as well as I'd like. I hope that something that was shared tonight is of benefit. I hope that what we shared and what I shared from my teachers, misunderstood men, can help us in whatever we're trying to do, because that's what they're here for, not to be worshipped or followed in a sick way, but to be used as what they are, channels and instruments of guidance and knowledge for all humanity. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to make the call. I'm going to say a few words. The first one will be Allahu Akbar, which means God is the greatest. I'm going to say it four times. Then I'm going to say, let me write, because I wrote down the English, so I'll make sure I give it to you right, that there is no God but Allah. I bear witness there is no God but Allah. I bear witness that Muhammad is his messenger. Then I'll say, come to prayer, come to success. God is the greatest. And then we'll say again, I bear witness there is no God but God. So just so you understand what we're saying, in whatever manner is comfortable for you, you can stand in that way. We usually stand with our heads bowed comfortably, palms up as if we're about to receive a gift. And with that said, and usually, but however it's comfortable for you, please, you don't have to do it our way. Attention prayer. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu amma Muhammad ar-Rasulullah. Ashhadu amanna Muhammad ar-Rasulullah. Hayya ala salah. Hayya ala salah. Hayya ala falah. Hayya ala falah. Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahmanirrahim. Malik Yawm al-Din. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Irna sirat al-mustaqim. Sirat al-ladina an'amta alayhim. Ghayrul maghdubi alayhim. Walla dalin. Ameen. Thank you, brothers and sisters. Peace be with you.